Just Out Stays In, the new writing initiative by Just Out Theatre. You are listening to Black Dark, written by Aimee Shields, directed by Lexie Ward, performed by Jessica Porter and Ewan Mulligan, and edited by Ben Wilson.
What's it to you, you old witch?
Love you too, Bender. What's happened?
What's happened to you? You're wetter than a lesbian in a fish shop.
It's tipping down and I had to walk all the way from the Arndale because the bus was full and it wouldn't let me on. What's the calice for? You're smoking again.
I saw him.
Who?
Tom Hardy, who do you think?
Callum.
Fucking Callum. At the gym.
What, by himself?
Stretching on the mat with Hunter.
Who's Hunter?
A personal trainer. He's American.
Typical.
He's got curly black hair.
Bastard.
He's beautiful.
Oh, I'm so sorry. He's probably stupid, though. PTs are just a collection of walking muscles held together with testosterone.
He's not. I asked the receptionist. He's working part-time while he pays his way through law school.
What a twat. Pass the gin.
Oh, don't have too much. You've got that thing later?
What thing?
Oh, the awards thing.
Nope.
It is Thursday, isn't it?
Yeah, you've not drank yourself into stupidity yet. I'm not going.
You can't not go. It was your idea. And we traipsed all round the Arndale for that outfit.
I don't work there anymore.
What?
I'm no longer employed by Charcoal Publishing.
Oh, he didn't sack you.
Nope. I resigned.
Today?
At about 3 o'clock this afternoon, effective. Immediately.
Why on earth?
Oh, I don't know, Sam. Why might I have walked out of this job? Was it the inappropriate comments? Was it the groping? Was it the way he treats me like his secretary? Or perhaps it was because he was running the company into the ground with his backwards ideas. I just couldn't take it anymore. I was standing in the prep room with Stuart and he was telling me all about his brilliant idea for a new range, and when I disagreed he told me I was being sensitive. Perhaps it was my time of the month.
What was it this time?
I told him he couldn't put old-timey minstrels on birthday cards. They were blacked up, for fuck's sake.
Christ alive.
He called me a snowflake. I just picked up Jenny's craft knife and I was halfway to stabbing him in the eye with it when I realised I best leave.
Oh God, Lala.
So I told him he could run the bloody company in the ground for all I care. He could stick his bloody creative director job up his arse. And I walked out. I don't have a job. What the hell am I going to do?
Well, you'll have to get another job.
No shit, Sherlock. Where?
Surely there's more than one greetings card company in Manchester.
Well, yeah, there is. One, anyway. But I'm hardly going to get a good reference, am I?
Oh, you never know. I always thought that Stuart had a bit of a thing for you.
Lara Williams is punctual, hard-working and mildly psychotic. She produces high-quality designs and is well-regarded in the industry, and once in a while she tries to stab you with a craft knife. I'm going to go and get a glass. And some tonic.
I'll drink it from the bottle. You're so middle class.
A might be unemployed, but there's no need for vulgarity.
Spoken like a true pleb. Bring the other bottle as well. There's not much left in this one.
You haven't done the bloody dishes.
I am distraught.
Ah, yes, my apologies. I forgot the Dowager Countess doesn't do her own dishes.
Christ, it's cold. Can we put the heating on?
I'd love to. It's not me who's turned it down, it's Geoffrey. He's set it to 17 degrees and changed the pasta.
He can't do that.
He can. I looked it up this morning. We live in a house of multiple occupancy, all flats of which are owned by the same landlord and have bills included. He's legally allowed to let us freeze to death.
What a bastard.
He's a landlord. They're all bastards.
Remember when you came to visit me at college and I took you to the dance studio in the old block?
Yeah.
Rumour has it that it's out of commission now because there was a first year ballet class who lit a fire in one of the corner bins to protest the conditions. £3,000 a year to freeze your bollocks off and have your career over by 30.
Could be worse.
How could it possibly be worse?
You could be one of the unlucky sods who paid 9,000 odd for the privilege.
True.
Oh, God. How am I going to pay the rent?
Didn't you get paid yesterday?
Yeah, this month's is pay, but what about next month? I didn't exactly give my 2 months' notice.
I know the guy in charge of the dancers at Powerhouse.
That doesn't surprise me.
Well, he might be able to get you something to tide you over.
Unlike you, dearest. I can't dance, and unlike you, I am also of no interest to the gay populace.
I meant on the bar or something. Didn't you do something like that when we were at uni?
The SU bar at St. Martin's and Powerhouse are a bit different. Though I suppose the punters are a bit less likely to grab my arse and tell me they've never shagged a northern bird, and are you all as dirty as they say?
Straight men are disgusting.
All men are disgusting.
Actually, no. It's people. People are fucking disgusting.
And that's why I'm gonna die alone with 40 cats.
Fuck's sake.
Nope, the trips haven't moved. At least I don't think so.
No, it looks like the whole street.
Who are you waving to?
Oh, that racist old crone we see sometimes in the post office. She's practically hanging out her window to look. Nosy bitch.
Well, this is all I need. I'm having the worst day in my life, and now we have to live in the dark. And I'm starving.
You're being a tiny bit melodramatic, dear.
Really? Am I?
I'm inclined to think you are.
My life's not shit. The car is off the road until I can find the money for a new clutch, which is probably going to be more than the bloody thing is worth. Mam's on at me all the time to settle down because I'm not getting any younger, and perhaps if I wore more makeup, I'd attract a man. I put £5 on last week, and the only reason I can think of is that I had half a lemon muffin. There's not even £5 in a whole lemon muffin. Now, I've got no job, and I'm going to have to go on the game.
No, you're right. You're being totally reasonable.
It's the worst day of my life.
What? Worse than when your nana died? Or you failed your driving test? Or that Marcus Foster jumped you in front of everyone in sociology?
If you're trying to cheer me up, it's not working.
All I'm saying is, perhaps you need to have a little perspective.
Ah, hark at you. One bloke dumps you and that's it. You're sacking it all off and becoming an estate agent. You're hideous and unlovable and you might as well do away with yourself.
Hey now, I was in love. I'm heartbroken. You don't know what it's like.
Of course I bloody do. It's just, I had my first heartbreak when I was 17 and I got it out the way. It's supposed to get easier when you get older, but you waited too long. Your first heartbreak at 29... I'm surprised you didn't keel over and die.
He's parading this hunter bloke under my nose, shoving it in my face.
Did you ever think, and I mean this in the nicest possible way, that perhaps it didn't mean as much to Callum as it did to you?
He said he loved me.
Marcus Foster told me he loved me so he could get into my knickers. Then he went round telling everyone he'd taken my virginity and dumped me in bloody sociology.
I thought you said virginity was a patriarchal construct designed to link women's value to their sexual experience, or something.
It is, but that's beside the point.
I took him to meet my dad. They got on like a house on fire, loads better than me and Dad ever did.
I know.
And we were going to Pride in Tel Aviv.
I know.
I was the only one saving up, you know.
Really?
Yeah. When I asked him how much he'd got, he said we'd only talked about it once and only in passing, and that it wasn't really something he wanted to do anyway.
What a dick. He kept going on and on about it.
Yeah, I know.
You were only together 6 months, you know.
It was the best 6 months of my life.
I know. Fuck him.
I hope his balls shrivel to raisins and his cock falls off.
You don't mean that.
No. I don't. You could go back, you know.
It's charcoal.
Yeah. Tell them that you didn't mean it. It was hormones or something.
I can't. They already think I'm mental.
Well, you are.
Thanks.
Works in court, though, doesn't it? People are always pleading insanity on Law and Order.
I told Penny in HR when I was going to counselling, because I needed the same 2 hours off every Tuesday afternoon and needed to rearrange my hours, and she's looked at me funny ever since.
Funny how?
Like I'm going to do a Britney and shave all my hair off or slit me wrists in the ladies. Like I'm a bomb about to go off.
I thought you all had that mental health first aid bollocks last year.
Yeah, we did. They say it's okay not to be okay and it's 1 in 4 of us and all that shite. But imagine if I rang up one Monday morning and told Stuart I can't come in because I'm feeling too sad. He'd tell me to pull myself together, we've got a deadline. And Francis would have jumped in my grave before you could say citralopram. Nope. It's better if they don't know. Doesn't matter now anyway, I don't really want to go back. I've hated the place for ages. Stuart's a prick, obviously, but Penny thinks I'm a head case and Francis would stab you in the back in a heartbeat. Christ. What am I going to tell Janet and Derek?
I am
You should have gone to Lidl on the way back from the gym. There's nothing remotely edible in this kitchen.
Well, forgive me for being blinded by my sad and sorry state. We could get a takeaway.
Hardly. I'm skin and you're on another diet.
I was, until this afternoon. I ate 2 galaxies and a Bueno on the way home. Fuck it. What's that you're drinking now?
Ouzo, from the cupboard.
That's ancient. From when you went to Xanti with, Chris.
I never went to Xanti with Chris. That was James.
What's the difference? Both tall, dark, and treated you like shit.
James was the one with the tattoos and the inability to make me come. And Chris was the junior doctor who wanted me to call him Daddy.
That's vile. Oh, so's this. It's probably poisonous by now.
All the better. Then I wouldn't have to tell me Mam and Dad about going on the dole.
When you go to your Mam's, do you still look in the fridge to see how full it is?
Yeah. I shouldn't really. It always makes me feel poor. There's always loads of M&S stuff in there, and she tries to fill me up, but she's always the first one to tell me when I've put weight on.
Oh, they'd love it if you moved back home.
Oh, well, that's depressing. Moving back home when you're nearly 30? And who would live with you? It's bad enough I can't get a deposit together, never mind if I have to go back home. It's like being a sort of suspended adolescence. God, that's horrific.
Hey, it's not your fault you don't have a mortgage.
Well, whose fault is it? Our friends can afford it. My sister can afford it.
Your little sister is a civil servant. I wouldn't wish that on anyone.
It's that she's married. Her wife's an accountant and Jen's just been promoted. It's expensive to be single. The world is built for couples, I swear.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry.
It's okay. No, really. You were right about him, of course. He was a twat from the start. Still hurts, though.
Yeah, I know.
You know, a girl at dance school used to be a sugar baby.
What the hell's a one of them?
You know, a kept woman of a sugar daddy.
Oh, dear.
She used to go to events with him occasionally, and he'd buy her things. Take her on holidays.
She must have had to shag him, though.
She said she did at the start, but by the end he was happy for a quick hand job before bed. He was about 50 when he ended things. And she travelled all over the world.
Not for me, I'm afraid. It'd be like going out with my dad, and I hate the idea of a man seeing me as a commodity. That's the whole problem with that generation. Acquire as much as you can, as quickly as you can, without any thought for the planet or poor bastards like you and me.
And the idea that hard work always pays off. Cunts. You know what Uncle Harry said to me at Christmas? You know what you should do, Sam lad? You should be one of those backing dancers on X Factor. As if I'd never thought of that. As if it was that easy. Not that I'll ever get the chance to do that now. My knee's totally fucked.
You never know. Physio can do wonders.
I'll be teaching music and movement for Key Stage 1 until I'm wearing nappies. And I thought I'd be the next Matthew Bourne. I might as well kill myself now.
What would you do? Buy a gun, like in a film? You'd be dramatic about it, I'm sure.
No. But I know what I wouldn't do.
You do?
Well, I certainly wouldn't drown myself. On CSI, the bodies always look so bloated and green. A handsome corpse does not a drowning victim make.
Would it matter?
Of course. In the scenario where I kill myself, I'm the front page of all the newspapers.
You're famous then?
Absolutely. I'm too old for that now, though. I was going to join the 27 Club, you know. The rich, famous and genius ones who are too good for this world and don't make it to 28.
But now you're too old for that.
Oh yes, I'll have to live forever now.
I wouldn't jump in front of a train.
Too risky?
No, it's not that. I wouldn't want to be an inconvenience to the passengers. It really pisses me off when my train is cancelled because some selfish git has jumped on the tracks. It takes ages to scrape them off. I once missed a whole client meeting.
Do people still stick their heads in the oven?
Suppose they must do.
Wouldn't work in our oven, though. It's electric.
Oh, my head is splitting already. This hangover's going to be horrendous.
You should drink some water or something.
I'll have to start looking for another job in the morning. That's if the lights come back on and I can have a shower.
You don't need to have a shower to use Google.
But we'd need the power on for that too, numpty. I don't suppose you've got any paracetamol.
None left, I'm afraid. Left my bag at the gym. I might have some of those oxycodone they gave me after my operation, but they're really strong. Is it really that bad?
I feel like someone is poking my eyes in.
Go on then. If you'll give me more of that awful ouzo. Don't take more than one, mind. You'll be knocked out for a week as it is.
Noted.
I hope the Lexie comes back on soon. I'm starving and I could murder a cuppa.
Samurai's fell on the sword, of course, but what if it didn't work? You'd be careering around bleeding everywhere.
And it's a bit difficult to drop a toaster in the bath. Especially here. You'd have to get the extension lead out. Who was that explorer who walked out into the blizzard and never came back?
Dunno.
Oh, you must know. You're full of useless knowledge.
Oh, I can't remember.
I'm just going out. I may be some time.
That wasn't suicide, though, was it? He was already dying. Plenty of people have done it by accident as well. They've gone too far with strangling themselves. Autoerotic asphyxiation.
Death by wank. It doesn't sound too bad.
There's this horrible custom in India, or there used to be anyway. If your husband died before you, you were expected to chuck yourself on his funeral pyre.
No man is worth that.
Want any more of this? I tried it once. I was about 19. I ended up in hospital. My parents told St. Martin's I was having my appendix out. They pretended there were complications because I was in for a couple of weeks. I missed your birthday party. The last place you want to be when you don't want to live is around a load of other people who feel the same. Hospital food is awful. You just want to be left alone, but there's always someone there coming to give you drugs or to ask about your feelings or make you eat. That's why I used to wear long sleeves all the time. The scars have faded now, though, of course.
Lara, no!
You've been listening to Black Dark, written by Aimee Shields, directed by Lexie Ward, performed by Jessica Porter and Ewan Mulligan, and edited by Ben Wilson.